The album title, Master of Reality, came from Geezer Butler, who said, "When you do an album, you've got the master tapes." So it was the master of the album, and all the lyrics were about reality. So at the time, it made sense for the band to write a song about the reality of their love for the devil's lettuce, marijuana.
This is grass.
You mean marijuana?
Yeah.
Sweet Leaf begins with a cough that moves from the left to the right channel as it becomes more distorted and ends in a loop. The cough comes from Tony, having just taken a toke on a joint given to him by Ozzy. When handed the joint, Tony was working on a separate acoustic track, but its inclusion for the beginning of Sweet Leaf makes sense, as the lyrics are essentially a love letter to cannabis. The cough sets up not only the lyrical theme of the song, but also the tempo. This love song for Bud was almost a love song for someone else. An earlier version of the lyrics was not drug related at all and included the lines such as,
"I want you, baby, to be my wife. The love and share it for the rest of my life."
The love song tone remained, but instead of the subject being a person, it became about the jazz cabbage after Geezer returned from Ireland. Geezer said, "I'd just come back from Dublin, and they had these cigarettes called Sweet Afton, which you could only get in Ireland, and we were going, what can we write about? I took out this cigarette packet, and as you open it, it's got on the lid, the sweetest leaf you can buy. And I was like, ah, sweet leaf." We hate to contradict Geezer's memory, but our research shows that packages of Sweet Aftons actually said, "the best that money can buy, not the sweetest leaf you can buy." And there was no mention of sweet leaf on the packaging. But there was another brand of cigarettes, Ogden, that was manufactured out of Liverpool and had the exact tagline of Sweet Leaf. Perhaps Geezer's mind conflated the two. If you think we got it wrong, let us know in the comments below. Some have insinuated that Sweet Leaf guitar riff was taken from Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention's Hungry Freak's Daddy. Geezer was a big fan of Zappa, I think it's a mere coincidence of notes. What isn't a coincidence of notes is the use of the riff in the Beastie Boys song, Rhymin' and Stealin'. In that song, the main guitar riff is paired with a loop of a drum sample from Led Zeppelin's When the Levee Breaks. The biggest song to ever give a tip of the hat to Sweet Leaf was the ending music passage of the Red Hot Chili Peppers' hit song, Give It Away. Chili Peppers guitarist John Frusciante is a known Sabbath fan and intentionally wanted to emulate the sounds of Master of Reality. He said, "The template for Stadium Arcadium was to have an album like Black Sabbath's Master of Reality, where the guitars are in stereo, hard left, hard right, and it's just the simple power chord and sounds as thick as you'd ever want it to sound." If you have early copies of the North American version of the first four albums, you have probably noticed extra song titles, but no actual additional songs. Those are ghost titles. Warner Brothers bands who played longer songs needed to give the appearance of more songs due to their publishing agreement. So for Black Sabbath to feature a minimum of 10 song titles, those additional titles were added afterward to various sections of songs, which was common practice amongst prog rock bands of the era. After Forever's floating instrumental intro was given one of those ghost titles, The Elegy. Where Sweet Leaf was light in topic, After Forever is like a fist hammering on the pulpit. An avowed Catholic who once considered becoming a priest, Geezer Butler wrote the words to this track partly to refute the band's satanic image. Yet as explicitly pro-Christian as the lyrics are, this fact eluded those who refused to believe it or look beyond the dark-sounding music. Ironically, despite the song's pious message, the band still managed to get into trouble, with complaints being directed at the line,
"We can like to see the Pope on the end of a rope. Do you think he's a fool?
course, out of context by its detractors. Geezer said, "That song just says that once you get to the end, are you going to be prepared for what you find? Have you lived a good life?" Geezer also once put it this way, "We were getting accused of all sorts of things, the whole Satan thing and everything. And After Forever is just about all these people that were following us around, that were into the occult and all the so-called Jesus freaks. So as a response to them, I wrote After Forever. It raises the question, when you're on your deathbed, who are you going to call, God or the devil?"
Who are you?
We're the band Sanctified. We play metal and punk, but with lyrics that inspire faith in Christ.
Yeah, we proved that Christian music can be tough and hardcore.
Yeah, you guys are real hardcore.
You bet your gosh darn rear end we are.
Send down from heaven the spirit and the glory.
After Forever may be the first Christian metal song ever written. It would be covered years later by the all-Christian metal band Striper with all the original lyrics intact. More influentially, it would establish a through line in the heavy metal genre of songs centered on biblical themes that carried over the decades with countless bands, but comes directly from Black Sabbath, as this was not a topic Deep Purple, Led Zeppelin, or even the acid rock bands were writing about. Unfortunately, even positive words can have a negative effect on someone mentally unstable. Apparently, serial killer David Berkowitz, aka Son of Sam, would use Sabbath lyrics in his rambling writings. Ozzy said, "You remember that guy from New York, Son of Sam, who was killing all the chicks? When they got into his apartment, he supposedly had the lyrics to After Forever written on his wall. I thought, fuck me. Are we going too far?" The way people misinterpret lyrics would continue to be an issue for Ozzy for years to come. Embryo is a 28-second track for solo guitar that gives birth to Children of the Grave. This two-string medieval jaunt is Tony letting you catch your breath before he and the rest of the band propel you on a galloping ride with the Horsemen of the Apocalypse. Tony said, "I'd like to come up with some instrumental guitar tracks like Embryo. It's a little classical thing to give it a little space and create some light and shade. If you listen to an album or even a song from start to finish and it's all pounding away, you don't notice the heaviness of it because there is no light in between it. And that's why sometimes in the middle of songs as well, I put a light part in to make the riff sound heavy when it comes back in." Children of the Grave, with the working title of Live in the Graveyard, illustrates the continuing Sabbath knack of making a song title sound as if it was something from a horror film, when in fact, the lyrics deals with a different topic entirely. Far from being about any kind of undead or similar theme, the track is another of Butler's anti-war messages coupled with his belief in nonviolent revolution. The titular children are marching to take over the world in the name of peace and love, being doomed only to become children of the grave if they fail this noble undertaking. Ozzy calls it the most kick-ass song we'd ever recorded. With its galloping, syncopated rhythm, like the four horsemen of the apocalypse on their way to the end of the world party, it's the precursor to many metal tunes. Iron Maiden owes a homage especially. It's as if all the turmoil in the inner city of Birmingham was converted into strident musical notes. The benefit of a 16-track studio over an 8-track studio gave Children of the Grave a notable extra layer of percussion, with Bill Ward's overdubbed timbals providing an unsettling tribal-like beat over the main riff. Children of the Grave may also be a nod to one of Tony's and Geezer's favorite classical composers, Gustav Holst. They are on record saying that Holst's Mars the Bringer of War from the Planet Suite directly influenced their song Black Sabbath. But melodically, you can also hear Mars the Bringer of War on Children of the Grave. If you are getting a Star Wars vibe too, you're not wrong. John Williams, who did the score for Star Wars, used Holst's Mars as an inspiration. The song simply has the rolling power of an unstoppable juggernaut, and has been a fixture in the band's set list, and Ozzy's solo set as well, ever since it first appeared. Indeed, as the years have progressed, the song gradually took over the ever-present encore of Paranoid as the set closer that diehards wanted. The track ends with some eerie sounding, echoing music with a repeated whispered voice intoning, which would loop endlessly in the runoff groove on the original vinyl. The closing sounds you hear are Calliope heard more fully on the instrumental version released on the deluxe edition. The outro section was credited on the initial US pressing as The Haunting, but the extra title was removed for future pressings. Although there is no factual evidence for it, I like to believe the in the Friday the 13th movies was in some ways influenced by the outro to Children of the Grave. Where Embryo is medieval, this interlude is somewhat more Renaissance. This 1.5 minute Iommi solo acoustic piece is far more than another Embryo. Despite its brief duration, this is a supremely delicate and beautifully composed piece with a couple of brilliantly evocative chord progressions thrown almost casually into the middle. The short length of the track may be indicative of Iommi's lack of confidence including such a piece on a Black Sabbath album, and it wouldn't be until the following years that he'd add longer and more developed works in the shape of Laguna Sunrise, Fluff, and the intro to Spiral Architect. It may also have been abbreviated by Roger Bain, who is notorious for cutting things like this. Orchid is a nice acoustic piece with some deft finger picking from Iommi that serves as a light contrast before being blasted into hell by the cloven hoofed Lord of this World. Many Sabbath fans claim Lord of This World to be the heaviest tune that Sabbath has ever recorded. Surprisingly, this most explicit reference to Satan is the most thoroughly Christian song on the album. The message is simple: God and the devil both exist, and if you don't willfully choose to follow God, you get the devil by default. The reference to Satan as Lord of This World is straight out of the New Testament. The ultra-heavy groove is surprisingly dynamic and rich. Geezer said, "Lord of This World was about Satan because it wasn't God's world, it was Satan's world. The devil's more in control now and happier than ever before. People can't come together. There's no equality. The higher you climb, the more people you have to cut down. You feel you're better than other people, that they're inferior to you, and it's a sin to put yourself above other people, and yet that's what people do." Lyrically, this is another piece that follows the After Forever model, being a Christian message couched in black imagery, a scathing rebuke against those who pursue materialistic, self-absorbed lives, unaware that this is the path to Satan, as summed up in this couplet. In retrospect, it was an incredible tightrope act that the band managed to pull off. While most bands would have been ridiculed for their Christian ideals, Black Sabbath's name, spooky imagery, and uber-heavy music carried them forward. In effect, they managed to use the cool trappings of the dark side common to occult bands like Black Widow and Coven while escaping their gimmicky natures due to their greater musical and lyrical depth, all the while making anti-satanic ideas fascinating. Sometime when the group was still called Earth, before rechristening themselves as Black Sabbath, Osborne and Butler had collaborated on the lyrics to a song called Changing Phases, which turned into Solitude.